We are in week four of our House of Hearts series. How many have been enjoying it so far? A few of you. Awesome. I want to encourage you, go to the podcast and watch the previous weeks. I know it will bless you, it will strengthen you. We're going to dive right into this morning. I don't have time to go through all the previous weeks, but you can catch up on the podcast. But I want to speak to you out of a passage out of Hebrews. Everyone say Hebrews. Some good coffee. Hebrews. You know, and in this context, before I go into this, there are these believers that the Hebrew writer that we aren't totally sure of. Scholars aren't totally sure. There's arguments about who it is. It doesn't really matter as much as it matters about what the purpose of the passage is. And the Hebrews writer is encouraging these believers that are equating their suffering with God must not be with us. Or equating their, or allowing the suffering and the challenges to stifle their faith and bring them into a place of doubt and unbelief. And so we're going to pick it up in verse 3 of chapter 12. Let's read along really quick. Think of all the hostility Jesus endured. Now, I'm going to need you guys to interact a little bit. This is darkness in here. I can't see anybody, okay? So if the front row can't do it, then we're really in trouble, okay? So I'm relying at least on the front row, okay, here. So listen, it's not going to get dark. Your interaction is going to make this place light up, okay? Okay, come on, Ken and Vicky, come on. Where's my, you're right there. I see that hand. Okay, let's dive into this. Think of all the hostility Jesus, endured from sinful people, speaking about what he went through all the way to the cross. Then you won't become weary and give up. Did you hear that? If you think about what he went through, you think about what somebody else went through that was hard, you think about what your father, your mother went through to get you to where you are today, think about those around you that have sacrificed and paved a way for you to start where you are right now. Think of those that pushed through those opposing circumstances, those contradictory circumstances. Think of Jesus who paid a price in his body for you to be free. Think about what he went through. And maybe you won't become weary and give up. Oh, such a powerful statement. You're so focused right now on what you're going through, and you want to quit, and you're weary, and you're tired, and you get so self-focused on your problem, you forget that your problem is just a mirrored image of somebody else's problem, and maybe not even as bad. And if they can move through it, if you just think about them, maybe you'll get through it as well and won't want to give up. When won't become weary and give up. Verse 4, after all, you have not yet given your lives in your struggle against sin. Verse 5, and have you forgotten the encouraging words God spoke to you as his children? He said, my child, don't make light of the Lord's discipline. And don't give up when he corrects you. That's a good word, eh? Man, because how many like correction? Usually nobody, but a wise man likes correction. Because a wise man, as they when they understand how their wisdom grows, they really understand and get a perspective that without correction, their wisdom will not grow in life. They will not have advancement in life. They will not be able to push through the obstacles in life. We need correction, course correction along our journey so we stay straight. So we don't go from the left to the right, back and forward, up and down. We can walk straight and stable. So don't make light of the Lord's discipline. Don't give up when he corrects you. Verse 6, for the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes each one he accepts as his child. Verse 7, as you endure this divine discipline, remember that God is treating you as his own children. Whoever heard of a child who's never disciplined by his father? If God doesn't discipline you as he does all his children, it means that you are illegitimate and are not really his children at all. Since we respected our earthly fathers who disciplined us, shouldn't we submit even more to the discipline of the Father of our spirits and live forever? Verse 10, for our earthly fathers disciplined us for a few years, doing the best they knew how, but God's discipline is always good for us so that we might share, everyone say share, in his holiness, partner, connect. Verse 11, no discipline is enjoyable while it's happening. How many agree with that? It's painful. But afterward, this is the promise, afterward, there will be a peaceful harvest. Everyone say harvest. harvest of right living for those who are trained in this way. So take a new grip with your tired hands and strengthen your weak knees. If you're taking notes, write this down if you can see in your phone. Write this down. Heart hacks. I want to talk about hacking into the hard heart. Turn to your neighbor right now and say, I think I'm having a heart hack. I think I'm having a heart hack. This whole passage really is about understanding the value of when God shows up in a way and you're going through something and you're feeling the consequence possibly of your actions at some level, because nobody in this room does everything perfect, right? Just get married and find out. I think marriage is one of the best things to make you a real Christian. Because you think you're good when you're alone, but all of a sudden when you get married and you live with somebody, all the stuff that you had in your heart the whole time comes to the surface, right? And you realize quickly how imperfect you really are. And God just, it's one avenue, God just uses that to hack into and through the walls that are around your heart that you've set up to protect yourself. So I'm going to go through a few of these things, but I was thinking about this, and I don't know where my man Josh is. Where is he? Where'd he go? But, you know, this is more his language. Bloomfield. But, you know, if you're, how many computer people do we have in here? How many computer people? Yeah. Not that many. Wow. That's it? Put your hands up. Wow, only a few people. Man, what else do you guys do? you know, I was thinking about this reality of what it looks like to hack into something. You know, and if you know anything about the computer world, you know this term hackers and people that spend their time in their mom's basement dark with all their computers, and so, you know, and they got unwashed dishes. This is the picture I have in my mind anyways. Unwashed dishes and video games on and couches and people playing PS3 and PS4 and Nintendo, whatever, and this is my version, and they're hacking into systems, and it's like the movies paint that picture, right? And they're spending their whole life hacking into government files, exposing this, exposing that. And really what hacking is when an unauthorized user pushes through some sort of what I would call, and I believe you would call if you're into this world, firewall or some sort of protection, pushes past that and hacks into, as an unauthorized user, into specific data that they want to expose or get access to. Well, I feel like God is like that hacker, only his room is a lot nicer in heaven. And he spends his time using different avenues around our life and situations around our life to hack into the firewalls that protect our heart. He wants to get into your heart. He's a heart God. He's a heart God. Paul said, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Transformation happens in the heart, but it starts in the head. And his whole dynamic, his whole pursuit of you is ultimately to get into your heart. Romans 10, verse 8 and 9, if you believe and confess that Jesus is the real deal and believe in your what? Heart, transformation happens. God wants to get into your heart. He wants to get into that place that all of those affections, all those emotions, all those longings and desires stem from and begin from. He wants to get in. Do you believe that? He wants to hack in to the hardness around your heart. And, you know, I was thinking about this, and we've all probably been hacked. How many have had their accounts hacked before? Anybody? How many have had, like, maybe a debit account hacked? Somebody maybe mimicked your card. There was fraudulent activity. You know, I remember one time, I think it was about 8 years ago, my wife and I, you know, my wife had purchased something from somewhere, and I don't remember where it was. Actually, I do now, but I do, because God spoke to us where it was after. But we got hacked. Our debit account got hacked, and it was out of Montreal. I guess that's where all the stuff happens. I'm just joking. But I got hacked, and I remember it's Montreal. I'm like, oh, wow, Montreal, it's on my debit. And there was money taken out, a big chunk of money taken out. And I remember we prayed, and we were praying for, like, just praying for justice, because you can do that. You know, you could actually pray for justice. There actually is a courtroom in heaven. I won't go there because it will be way over your heads, and you'll think I'm crazy. But there's an actually courtroom in heaven. It's in the scripture. And you can bring your case against the court in prayer. That's the kind of stuff we talk about in my schools. And so we went in faith, because Hebrews 4, verse 16 says that we boldly can boldly approach the throne of grace to obtain mercy in time of need. So if I can approach the throne, man, I can talk to the judge himself and get some justice. So I was talking to God saying, hey, somebody hacked in to our account, and Michelle and I, and we had a vision of what it was and where it was, got the location, and we just began to pray into that, and we ended up getting it all back. But all that to say, as I remember the feeling, no one likes the feeling of being hacked. No one likes the feeling of being stolen from or invaded. How many have had their car broken into? Yeah, I've had my car broken into. I had a whole book that I had been writing that I did not back up stolen. Talk about depression. Lots of time. Yet I had my journal. I had my journal. They stole my journal full of prophetic words and words of knowledge and prayers and stuff and encounters. They stole my journal because it's part of my bag. And I'm like, man, that journal, that's going to release like judgment on that person. I'm telling you, it was like holy. I'm just joking. But it was like, I mean, if they wanted to know who they stole from, they would find out very quickly based upon my personal journal. And anyways, I had like over 5,000 lots worth of stuff stolen out of my car. And I remember when I was coming up to my car before I knew there was anything stolen from it, I was coming up and over my car in the parking garage, and it was downtown on York Street. Never park in, what's it called now? Maybe I shouldn't talk about that. I feel bad. I don't want to like. But anyways, yeah, never park on York Street. But anyways, there's a parking lot there. But anyways, so I walk up to my car, and over my car on a big beam, like a cement beam, was spray painted the words peace. And I had been talking about peace in the storm, and immediately when I went into that situation, I'm like, man, I'm going to need peace for this next thing I'm about to experience. I had this feeling, and I went in and saw my car was, my car had been broken into. And, you know, honestly, I didn't feel peace right away, you know. I really didn't. But I knew what God was saying. He wanted me to find peace in the midst of this. And so, but no one likes to be hacked into. I feel like it's kind of like a relationship, you know, if you've ever dated or you've married somebody that was like a hard person to get into. Anybody ever had that? You know, somebody was hard, like you had to pursue them. You know what I'm talking about? Anybody? Nobody is just really easy for you guys, eh? You just kind of said, hey, want to go out? You're like, sure, yeah, let's get married, sure. There was no pursuit. I know my wife was like a safe that was locked with 10 different codes. And after I got the code, I had to have the right key. After the right key, there was another safe inside. I'm just joking. No, I'm exaggerating. But at first, man, I had to pursue my wife hard and hack into and through the walls around her to get her to realize that I was the man for her. You know, it took some time. But eventually, at the right time, it worked itself out. But God wants to get into our hearts. And he sometimes is the unauthorized, in our minds, user that's trying to get in. We have not authorized him to come. We've not authorized him to invade our personal space. But sometimes, because he's God and he can, he just does it because he so wants all of you. There's times when we authorize him and say, hey, you're welcome in this place. You're welcome. But then there's times when, you know, he has to just do it. He has to just come and slap you on the face. And say, I'm coming, whether you like it or not. Paul, riding on a pony, like Yankee Doodle, okay? Acts chapter 9. He was a killer of Christians, a murderer, walking down. His name was Saul, in his unredeemed name. Didn't have an old identification of sin and iniquity and pain and woundedness. And he was a murderer. And God comes down by his grace and whacks him, smacks him off his pony, and blinds him for 3 days. Did Paul invite that? No. God, as an unauthorized user, hacked into Paul's heart right there and said, Paul, I am the Lord. I am the one you're persecuting. And all of a sudden, he had a realization. Blind for 3 days. Because sometimes you got to go blind to your old way of life for a season to prepare you for the new way of life that you haven't seen yet. Oh, there's Josh. So I'm thinking about this, man. God wants to hack into our heart. He doesn't need our authorization. And we have these protective walls that all of us have, right? You guys know, if you're married, you know the walls of your spouse. You know the walls of your friends, your coworkers, your business partners. You know the no-go zones of your parents. You know the no-go zones sometimes of those that you're closest to, right? You know what I'm talking about? The walls that are hard to break through. You don't bring up the political conversation. You don't bring up the religious conversation because you know the walls, right? You know, you don't tell your sister how to parent their their children. You don't tell your friend how to parent their children when you don't even have children. You know the walls, right? You know what I'm talking about. There's walls. There's firewalls. I was thinking about this. I wish I had like a computer guy with me up here, because I was thinking about this. It's like God's like a virus that just keeps coming, trying to hack into our system. But he wants our whole system to shut down so he can reboot us and restore us from a heavenly backup. He wants us to sacrifice a ram so he can bring back the right memory. I knew you'd like that. See, that's why you should be up here, Josh. Moses was hacked. Paul was hacked. David was hacked. Every disciple, every person that ever connected with Jesus had a moment and a season where they were hacked into so God can pull them into a place where they had a healthy heart to do something incredible in life. So tell your neighbor, I'm having a heart hack today. Because every hard season is a heart season. Write that down. Every hard season that you're going through really is not about how hard it is. It's really about your heart, about creating and establishing in you a healthy heart. So if you're in a hard season, remember this. It's a heart season. What is God doing in your heart when it's hard? Because he wants to come in. He wants to create in you a healthy house of hearts. Because you are that house. So I want to give you four avenues. I want to outline four avenues today that God will use to hack into our lives. Number one, people hacks. Write this down. People hacks, Hebrews 12, verse 3 to 4. Think of all the hostility, which is strife and contradiction and opposition that Jesus endured from sinful people. Then you won't become weary and give up. So you see, people became a problem for Jesus. You can have problems at work. You can have problems in a task, in a situation, in a career from advancing. But there's no problem like a people problem. When you include the drama, the emotional, the backbiting, the gossip, the backstabbing, there's no problems like people problems. Really, that's why people that lead people often have a hard time and grow weary very quickly. Because people weary people, you know? You don't want my position. Just joking. But people hacks, and God uses people and opposition to help develop in us our purpose. You see, God looks at you and says, there's potential in you, but I need the right people to get around you and the wrong people to get around you to expose the heart within you. I need the right people around you to lift you up and the wrong people around you to help show you what perseverance looks like. And I'm not even saying that God, you know, positions like a game of chess these things into our lives, but we live in a fallen world. We live in a roughed out world, right? And stuff happens. And so we live in a world where stuff happens, and as a result, God will use that stuff in hard seasons so that we can develop our heart culture. Because he wants to hack in, and he'll use people to hack in. And in Jesus' case, you know what? People came against Jesus. They opposed him. They contradicted him. They created strife and fear, and they pushed against him. But God was testing even his own son to showcase that he had the right heart to do the right thing. He's going to give his life for all mankind, so he's got to push through this. And so, I want Jesus' heart to come to the surface and showcase love to all mankind. And so these things are set up in our lives. These hostile moments are set up in our lives to help us. Whatever you do in life, if you are leading people, you will have, say it, people problems. People's potential does not get drawn out without great people problems. But it's draining, isn't it? Galatians 6, verse 9, read this with me. May we never tire of doing what is good and right before our Lord, because in his, I love this. Oh, look at that. In his season. When is his season for you for harvest? You know, you want the result now, right? Start the business. You want the first $3 million check right now. But there's a process to harvest. There's seed, there's time, and there's harvest. And no one likes time. Everyone, it's easy to plant the seed, to start something, but the time in between the seed and the harvest is the challenging process. That actually is the most important part of our purpose, but often we forget. So in time is the preparation for our great harvest, but it's his season, it's his time. But it says, may we never tire of doing good and pushing forward and advancing what is good and right before our Lord, because in his season we shall bring in a great harvest. If, are you here with me? If we can just persist. Man, I can't tell you, I am so thankful for the people problems and the support of the right people in the right seasons. I am so thankful for sometimes the challenges that have come with people problems, because they have sculpted me, made me a better person. And our enemy is not even people. Our problem really isn't even the people itself. Even Ephesians 6 says, God says through Paul that, hey, your wrestle is not even against the people around you. It's against all the stuff out there that's influencing the people around you. They don't even know they're doing it. Maybe their perspective's off. Maybe they're talking bad about you because they don't even know you. You know? But those things actually make you a better person if you have perspective. They're all a part of frustrating you to success. I've chosen to let frustration actually drive me more to my knees and more to success than letting it rob me of success and living in a place of failure. So when I get the push, I push harder because I know obviously there's something good that's going to happen out of it. When you get pushed down, that means get up again, because there's something that someone out there, and his name starts with an S, Satan does not want you to have. Because his whole role is to steal, kill, and destroy by help creating walls around your life where you don't let God hack in to get in so that he can prepare you for what he has for you. So we have people hacks. And then number two, we have personal hacks. We have personal hacks. Personal hacks. What is that? What are your personal thoughts in this season? What are your personal struggles? What are your personal, maybe things that nobody knows about? The challenges that nobody around you that you really care about knows about? The things that on the outside you may be looking really good, you may be sounding good, but on the inside, what are the personal things that you're going through in your mind? The personal struggles that, you know, whether you believe in God or not, I believe this, God is trying to get your attention. He's a God of all humanity. His name is Jesus Christ. He loves all people equally. He wants to hack into everybody's heart. Luke says in the Gospel of Luke that it's his will that none shall perish. Hell was not created for people. It was created for the fallen angels and Satan himself. We choose to disconnect ourselves from God by rejecting his love over our lives. We choose it, not God. We've been given a free will. We've been given the keys to his Rolls Royce, and we can drive it wherever we want to. And it just so happens that Adam and Eve chose to drive into the wrong tree and mess it all up for all of us. But thank God for Jesus, who was called the second Adam, who redeemed us back to God himself in relationship by dying on a cross. He said, I'm going to break down all the walls of hostility, all the firewalls of hostility in people's lives so that I can create a space where every heart can get hacked into. Authorized or unauthorized. He's just going to do it. He's going to do it. Personal hacks. What are you trying to do that isn't working out for you? What is the struggle right now? Let's go to verse 5 of chapter 13. And have you forgotten the encouraging words God spoke to you as his children? He said, my child, don't make light. Everyone say light. Of the Lord's discipline. And don't give up when he corrects you. For the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes each one he accepts, which means expresses personal interest in as his child. Let's talk about this phrase, my child, don't make light. I was interested to really understanding, and it literally means this, caring too little. You ever feel like sometimes you're living a challenge, consequence, your wife, your husband, your friend, your business partner, your children, your parents have told you the same thing over and over again, and they're like the same, maybe you feel like you're a failure, maybe you feel like you just can't do it, you can't be good enough, you can't move forward, and you're hearing the same thing over and over again. You know in and of yourself that maybe it's a personal struggle, and maybe God is using people to try to get in to get you aware of this thing that has to change that you don't want to change. But if you really think about it long enough, you really do want it to change, but you just don't know how to change it. You know what I'm talking about? Okay, well, when he says don't make light of the Lord's discipline, in other words, don't make light of the consequences that you feel when people are trying to always hack into your life and tell you the same thing. He's saying this, don't care too little about it. In other words, I want you to highlight it. I want you to honor it. Because if you can honor this thing that you're facing and you're living, you'll have success. He says, it literally means don't neglect it as a habit. How many know people that keep neglecting as a habit the same thing that comes every single week? Change this, change that. You never change. Change this, change that. And neglect the correction. They neglect the discipline because they don't want it. And they always think everybody else is wrong and they're always right. He's saying, don't care too little. Listen to the people in your life that are saying the same thing over and over again. For the Lord disciplines, so it's a good thing. He corrects those he loves. Hey, if you're getting some discipline and you're experiencing some challenges, it's a sign that, man, there's someone that really loves you because he wants you to succeed. And he knows that if you can conquer A, B, C, D, you'll get to E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, and Z. Now I know my, you know, I hear that song all the time at my house. But do not keep neglecting. And then he says this, don't make light of the Lord's what? Discipline. Write this down. The discipline you are experiencing is directly tied to the destiny over your life. The thing that keeps reoccurring over and over again. That's why Israel walked around for 40 years never achieving and coming into their purpose. And a whole generation had to die because they just couldn't change. You know, the key to revival, reformation in life and in a city is people that will change when the God of change says, hey, it's time to change. It's called repentance. There's a word for it. It's called repentance. Change the way that you think about the situation. You're still stuck in the past, the way things that were done, the way things that were done in your day that you were comfortable with. Change with me. I am the one who does not change, but I'm always changing how I do what I do. I'm always changing my methods. And if you can change with the change, really it's a sign that you are of a repentant heart. You're always thinking differently. You're always changing your vantage point. You're moving to the penthouse. That's what the word means. The penthouse, the high place of God. And you're going, you're recalibrating your perspective of a situation. This word for discipline, it literally means to train someone to reach full development and maturity. It means to train someone to reach full development and maturity. It's not a bad word, you guys. It's actually a good word. It's where we get the phrase child training from. We think it's like this, you know, God up there, he's like beating us with a rod and a stick in the face. And he's like, you are a bad boy on my naughty list. No Christmas for you. Coal in your stocking. That's not how he actually is contextualizing this. Paul, or whoever the writer they believe could be Paul, is the Hebrew writer, is saying, listen, don't equate your suffering with God leaving you or disconnecting himself from you. Let it become something that builds you. Let your challenge become something that strengthens you. Let him discipline you, because if he disciplines you, it's a sign that he loves you. And it's training to bring you into the full development of your destiny and your future. So it's good. When you feel like God's hacking in through people, let it happen. Put the code in to break down your firewall. Let him in. Let him have full access. And he wants to shut down some things in your life for a season so you could recalibrate and restore. Restore from heavenly backup. I'm trying. How many have had like a story where they felt like through people, God hacked into their life? Through people, and it is hard. It was hard. Hopefully everybody at some point. Hopefully right now you have people that are trying to hack into your life. Whether it's good or bad. Whether it's the wrong people or the right people, there's good on both sides. One trains me to become stronger, my frustration moves me, and one just strengthens and supports me. But they all come back to strength in the end anyways, because God is a redemptive God. I had that. One of my best friends, Caleb, pastor in the city, had this encounter with Jesus at 18 years old, and I remember wanting nothing to do with it. And there was a big division between us in relationship, and it was hard, and we every time we'd get together, he'd be like talking to me about Jesus, and I literally despised it, because when you're not in the right place, man, you have a lot of walls up, right? He knew I had walls. Man, I was the guy with major walls. And I remember there was some moments where I could tell there was a God trying to hack into my heart. You know, I remember a scenario where I wasn't a crier in public. I was not someone that showed emotion. In fact, I hated Pentecostal people. There was a hatred. Before I knew Jesus, I had a hatred. I thought they were way too emotional, way all weird, wacky. And I thought they were like this way too emotional. I just didn't understand. You know, I didn't understand. Because when you don't understand what you don't understand, usually it warps your experience and your mindsets about certain things. And I remember, man, I didn't want to express emotion, especially when it comes to like an invisible God that I'd never really known or understood to be real and true. And I remember, you know, being in this scenario where I was with like 40 people, and like, this is not like me. And everybody was talking about their struggle. And all of a sudden, I felt something grip my throat, and out of my mouth, I started to talk about my struggle. And I broke down bawling my eyes out in front of 40 people. And everyone in the room knew my situation and knew that I was the guy that did not talk about their struggle. I was the guy that had all the firewalls up. I was the guy with the pride, trying to maintain, you know, the pride of how I was perceived. And I was that guy, and I broke, and there wasn't a dry eye in the whole room. And Caleb was in that room, and he had prayed for me, and they all knew something was happening in Sean's heart. God was hacking in. But that wasn't the end for me. That was just the beginning. It was about 4 to 6 months later where I got a phone call at 1 a.m. in the morning from him, and he was having this encounter with Jesus in his bedroom, and God spoke to him and said, go call Sean. And he knew I still had the walls up, but some of the walls were coming down. And he spoke to me and said some things that God had spoken to him. I didn't even know that God spoke at this point. I didn't understand that. I didn't believe that there was a voice part of God. I thought there was just this like iconic figure. And so I literally was in my room at in the basement at 1 a.m. in the morning, and he's calling and he's shaking and he's telling me all these things that he had no way of knowing, and it blew my mind. And I remember in that room looking up to the left corner of my basement, and I remember in my mind thinking, man, this is freaky. Like, I feel like there's an unauthorized user trying to like get in. I don't like it. Like, something's like trying to get in, you know? It's like the firewall's being penetrated. Come on, let's stop it, hackers. Come on, let's stop it, you know? It's like, that's what I felt like. I felt like, man, I was being invaded. My personal space was being invaded. There was a God that was after me. And it was all coming through people. But as a result of that encounter and a few more things that happened later on, not too long after, I made a decision to let Jesus into my life. And then I made a commitment. Because you can make a decision, but to make the commitment, that's where the fruit is. It's in the commitment, not the decision. It's in the commitment. So we have people hacks, personal hacks. Number three, write this down. Number three, process hacks. Let's read it. Verse 7, continue on this passage. As you endure this divine discipline. Remember that God is treating you as his own children. As you endure. Skip over to verse 10. For our earthly fathers disciplined us for a few years. It was a process. Right? How many right now feel like they're in a hard process? Every hard season's a heart season. Every one of us is in a process at some level. Some processes are harder, but God will use these seasons and these processes to hack into our lives. In fact, I have a whole message called our second greatest mentor, and I believe it's our season. The circumstances and season in our life can mentor us and groom us and prepare us if we let it. It's called our process, and God will allow things in the process to put pressure on us, to help bring out the best in us. That word for endure means to stand your ground or to remain under the load. How many feel a load? How many feel a load? Come on, if you're in faith and you're advancing and you're building something and you have a vision and a dream, you're under a load. Maybe we don't always feel the ramifications of that load, but you're under it. But it's in that place. Endurance looks like standing your ground under that load, and you keep on going forward. That's why in the beginning it says, hey, think about what Jesus went through so you don't give up and quit. Because what you're going through is nothing in comparison than somebody who gave his entire life and took on the sin, your sin, before you were ever even born, past, present, and future, in his body. The pain of that, nobody could compare to. On top of that, a physical crucifixion, which is the most excruciating torture you could go through. Body being lacerated, his intestines literally being exposed and his insides being exposed because of the lacerations on his back, ripping the flesh off his back. I mean, the guy went through some pain. He went through a process. He endured under the load of the cross, close to 180 pounds, walking all the way up to this place to give his life on it for you. Because he said, I want to redeem mankind. I gotta let the Father hack in to show the heart of love that's on the inside of me by going through this process. He's hacking into your process. We have to endure. And I remember there was a season of my life where in ministry, and I'd been traveling for some time, and you know, I never talked about money. And I can't even tell you in that time why. I never talked about money. I didn't, at that time, feel like I had an issue with it personally. You know, I was always, before I met Michelle, always a generous giver, always understood the context of giving and giving God my first, and I got that as an individual knowing God. I always got that. But there was a challenge that God began to give me, and he said, why don't you talk about it publicly? And he began to invade my process, and I had no idea what my process would look like, but I could tell God was speaking to me and hacking into this process. And then I get this opportunity. This is how God hacked into me. I was invited to this network in Canada to do six days of live TV, 6 hours a day, live, broadcast around the world, live. Close to a viewership of 98 million. So I'm thinking, okay, so, and I really had no idea what I was doing. And they asked me to come in. There was three other speakers. And I didn't get the memo as to what exactly I was doing. Somehow I missed the communication of what exactly I was doing. I thought I was going there being interviewed 6 hours a day. Okay, think about it. 6 hours a day live for 5 to 6 days. No editing. Okay? So here I go. I had these like long dreadlocks, these like really scary beard. I'm like, why am I the guy? All these older, you know, seasoned people, you know? And I'm like, why am I on there? I was weird. When I come and I met the people, I'm like, I feel like I didn't fit. I was like the black sheep. I'm like the youngest, and I'm like, it's just really weird. And so I'm there, and I realize on the way there, I got the memo of what it was all about. The whole thing was about raising money for the network. I'm going from not wanting to talk about money publicly to now my introduction, my baptism of fire, literally is talking about it on an international platform for 6 hours a day, for a week, live. Talk about God hacking into the process. Something happened on that day. Something happened to me. It opened me up. It opened my spirit up. It opened me up. And I realized, man, like God wants me to get something out of this. And it totally changed my perspective. It gave me a confidence. It gave me an understanding of what God thinks about money and how to begin to help people understand that. Because you can, one thing for you to understand it, but to develop language to help other people understand that is a whole different thing. You can know what you know, but until you can impart what you know, you're immature. There's the immaturity about you. That's okay. We're all at levels of immaturity. That's okay. It's not a rebuke. I'm just saying that we're all at different levels of immaturity, and until we can communicate what we know well, we'll never multiply ourselves in somebody else, which is the whole calling that we have on all of our lives, to take what we have and multiply it and give it away. And give it away. So I remember God had to hack into my process. Maybe for you, you have an issue with finances. You know, and it's reasons like we do these end-of-the-year offerings to help the people begin to trust God. One of the things that we're doing is saying, hey, as you sacrifice and as you invest into this house, moving us into 2017, what are you believing for in your family? What are you believing for in your finances? What are you believing for in your business? Because I'm telling you, every time my wife and I have stepped out in radical faith saying, we're going to sow this, believing for this, I'm telling you, almost all the time, those things happen. And they happen in the most incredible way. Why? Because we applied faith to the step. And we let God into the process that he's been trying to get in for a long time, but we just don't see it. We put up these walls. Well, don't talk to me about finances. My parents always struggle about with finances. Well, maybe you need to do something different that they never did to get something that they never had. And let's step out a little bit. Believe God. He's given it to you anyways. So we have people hacks, personal hacks, and process hacks. Number four, our last avenue that God uses is painful hacks. Write this down. Painful hacks. Verse 11 to 12 says this: no discipline is enjoyable while it's happening. It's painful, right? You would agree. Man, when we're faced with this stuff, you made a mistake. Everyone around you knows it, right? It's public, right? Your family knows it. Your friends know it. You feel like a failure. You feel guilty. You feel like now they're never going to trust me again. I can't move forward. It's painful. Let that process continue, because if you can move through that, you are one step closer to letting God develop you into the mature person you're called to be. Because the discipline that the writer is talking about here is the kind of discipline that develops you, prepares you, moves you into your destiny. No discipline is enjoyable while it's happening. It's painful. But afterward, there will be what? A peaceful. Come on, say it. Peaceful harvest. Man, we want the harvest, right? We want the end result. We want, man, my daughter Harvest is like a dream. Like, you look at her, every time I look at her, she smiles. It's everybody, every time they look at her, she smiles. Eh? It's like incredible. I've never seen, out of all of our kids, a baby that smiles so consistently. Would you agree? Just so consistently. When I look at my daughter, honestly, everything that's complicated in my life right now goes out the door. I'm like, man, it's so simple. When I look at my daughter, her smile reminds me of how simple life really should be. I look at her and it's like, man, she's just like, oh, she's just so, she's just smiling. Like, she has no grid for what's going on around her. You know? But it just reminds me of how simple things are. It's like peaceful harvest. I look at her, it's like I just feel peace. If I feel a little bit stressed, a little overwhelmed, I look at my daughter, honestly, I feel peace. And her name's Harvest, so it's like peaceful harvest. This is my scripture. Peaceful harvest. Peaceful harvest. Like, thank you. Peaceful harvest. But afterward, there'll be a peaceful harvest of right living for those who are what? Trained. So how do we get the peaceful harvest? Let yourself get trained. That word is where we get the English word gymnasium from. Let God position you in his gymnasium where you train naked. That's what the word means, to train naked. Nothing hindering, nothing holding you back. Fully exposed, letting God in, letting God hack into every part of you. It literally means to train naked, to train as an athlete would in a loincloth. Letting God into all the stuff that's covering you and holding you back from him, seeing you really as you really are. Because he sees you anyways, but he wants you to see yourself as you really are so he can do what he wants to do in you. So if you want the harvest, let him train you. Let him hack into your heart. That's why there's a heart attack today. He's attacking your heart. He wants to get in, getting through the firewalls of your life so that he can develop you. It means to train with one's full effort, like a pro athlete. It means to have regular exercise with graduated resistance. I love that, eh? Graduated resistance, you know? So you conquer one thing, and then God graduates you to the next thing. But guess what? On that next thing, you have more resistance to graduate through. And then you get through that, and you go higher. And then you have more resistance. At level one, if you were to experience level four, it would take you out. But God knows along the journey, as you let him train you, you will be able to handle every level he brings you into. Every step that you take, he's preparing you, positioning you for, because he dealt with that issue at that step. Then the next step, it's this issue. Then the next step, it's this issue. And it's all to develop you into who God's called you to be. Man, I could tell you this. I could tell you, like, I had this dream on November 25th, which was this last week, Thursday night, really coming into Friday morning. I had this dream. And there was thousands of people with me. And I was on this mound in the middle of what looked like this beautiful sea. It wasn't like tropical, like we think beautiful, we think tropical and like, you know, bright, bright blue, clear water. It wasn't like that, but it was beautiful. The picture was, it looked so refreshing, I just wanted to dive in. Like, it was refreshing, but there were waves. It wasn't calm, there were waves, but there was this anticipation. It's like we saw this beautiful thing that we were about to embark on. There was thousands with me, and Josh was there, and he was in front of me, and I remember people that I knew were with me, and some of our team were with me, and were there, and I was looking, and I remember somebody shouted out, "This is harvest season! This is harvest season!" And then I said, "Yes, this is the harvest!" And I was thinking about my daughter at the time. In that moment, I took out my phone in the dream to Snapchat it. It's funny. I wanted to capture the moment, because listen, this is that moment. God wants us to capture this moment, this season. This is a season where God wants us to remember. Capture this moment, because what I'm about to do is different than you've ever seen before or known before. So capture this moment. I wanted to capture that moment. And then Josh dove in, because I know this. Worship is going to lead us into this next season. Worship's going to lead us into this next season. Songwriting, anthems that come out of this house will lead us into this next season. Worship's going to dive in and take us places that we've never gone before. It's our weapon of warfare to conquer. It's our weapon to move forward. When it gets hard, we worship harder. When somebody pushes us down, the devil pushes us down, we get up stronger and we worship and acknowledge that God is still God, even over the storm and even over the challenge. So I remember once worship dove in, we all started diving in, and it was like the most refreshing water. It was like deep blue, but man, it was waves, and you could think maybe it's intimidating, but it wasn't. It was like, it energized us. And then literally, the next day, so that was Friday morning, I had that dream before I got up. That day, I was interviewing a guy from the U.S., he's from Brazil, and I was interviewing him, and he's living in Connecticut, talking about where we're at, what we're doing. And I didn't tell him this. He opened up his mouth and said, "You know, I had this dream about you last Friday." It was one week before. He's like, "You were on this mound and you were surrounded by water. And there were people around you that you knew, like some of your team, and you were surrounded by water, and there was waves coming from all different sides. And you were on this mound, and you were talking about the faithfulness of God, the goodness of God, the grace of God." And he sang this the morning that I had the dream. I stopped him. I'm like, "Whoa, whoa, 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 whoa." Like, give me the detail. And as he gave me the detail, it was like almost verbatim the dream that I had. I'm thinking, "God, what are you saying? There's something about a peaceful harvest. But we got to go through what we're going through. God is setting us up for something amazing. It's a peaceful harvest, but we got to go through the development stage. And it's challenging, but it's going to energize us. It's going to refresh us. 2017 is going to be the most refreshing year of this house." Close with this, Zechariah chapter 2. I'm going to close with this prophet who prophesied about the coming Messiah, Jesus Christ. Speaking about Jerusalem, speaking about his people, the people that he loves so much, the people in Jerusalem that he had a desire to lift up, to develop, a people and a city that he cared so much about, that represented him in so many different ways. And it was an angel that God used to speak this word. And the angel said this, "Run, speak to that young man, saying, Jerusalem will be inhabited like villages without walls." It speaks about extension, expansion, growth, harvest, spreading out into the open country. A church without walls, a church that touches the culture. Something that all of a sudden everyone around you knows about. Because of the great number of people and livestock in it. "For I," declares the Lord, "will be a wall of fire around her, protecting her from enemies, and I will be the glory in her midst." You see what he's saying here? Don't let those walls those firewalls be the thing that stops you from developing, because I have a wall. I have a firewall that I want to put in your life to protect you, prepare you, position you, to advance you. Come on, stand up with me. God wants to do something in your life in this season. He has a firewall for you. He has a wall of protection. No longer are you going to let the walls of your heart determine where you go, what you do, but you're going to let His guidance be the wall that prepares you.